Hey everybody, it is topic video time. This week I asked you who are your favorite movie directors and why. This first one says Federico Fellini. He was able to create such different and lovable characters throughout all of his films. He had his own unique, surreal style, Fellini-esque, of filmmaking, which made his film so different from any other film. For instance, he always had those random characters pop up in the corner of shots just to simply wave or smile. His sets were bigger than life. His films always held a deep philosophical purpose, specifically La Dolce Vita, 8½, and La Strada. I'd say his most enjoyable films were I Vitelloni and Amarcord. So with Fellini, he's somebody that I love. I loved really specifically, I got into him in college. And it's funny because I went back and decided to review a Fellini film recently, Knights of Cabiria. And that used to be one of my favorite films ever. I adored it, and I hadn't seen it in so many years. And I have to say, that's an earlier film for Fellini. So it was in the 1950s. Back then, he was much more kind of subtle and stripped down and more influenced by Italian neorealism. And that's before he developed really his own distinct style. And I was just so struck by the emotional depth of that film, the weight of it, the power, as well as just having those little hints of the surreal or the eccentric, hints of humor, as if this character, Cabiria, it's as if she belongs in a film that Fellini did later on, but she's in a world that's more brutal and realistic, which ironically really works for the film. And that's what I think is amazing about Fellini. A lot of film directors, you watch their early work and they feel more like, you know, like beginner works. They feel like exercises or whatever. And though Fellini became much more conceptual and much more, you know, distinct in his point of view as he got older and his films became much more, as I say, like surrealistic and all of that, more experimental. The films in the beginning of his career are the ones that really have the emotional weight for me. And that was somehow carried over the course of his career. So I think he started at such a really strong place with a core foundation that is very solid, and that kind of carried him through. And then of course, you know, like 8½ being that great film that is about like the creative process and kind of him being very meta, looking at himself as an artist and a creator. And similarly to La Dolce Vita, very much an existential crisis of sorts. You look at films like Juliet of the Spirits, the colors and the beauty of that, very psychedelic in a lots of ways. He loves that kind of performance art circus imagery, always with a hint of humor amidst the pain, amidst the complexity. I always thought that if Fellini made movies that were animated, I feel like Al Hirschfeld would have to be the person who is designing the characters, just because there is a sort of cartooniness to them, a cheekiness to them. And like I said last week, we were talking about film composers. I do think that the collaboration between Rota and Fellini is maybe the greatest collaborative music director team maybe of all time. What he achieved with Fellini was nothing short of magical. And I hate to say that word because it sounds so cheesy, but it's really true. For me, it's Tarkovsky. He understood cinema like no other filmmaker, how to combine substance and style together to make something that's absolutely gorgeous, yet still so thought-provoking. Even Bergman called him the greatest of them all, so what more do you need? Yeah, so I would say that Tarkovsky, even amidst the great auteurs, even amidst the Fellinis and the Stanley Kubricks and all of that, he still sets himself apart from those in terms of originality, which is really, really saying something. And when I think about movie directors, he's the one I think of where I think he has created his own style that is less influenced by other people more than any of them. It's like when you watch his films, they are so, so much a part of his mind and so distinct that it's almost hard to describe. The greatest directors always borrow from somebody else. That's normal because we develop our love for cinema and everything from something. So it's already there in our minds and we're drawing upon it so we can hopefully develop our own style. And sometimes you can take old conventions or whatever and give them a new spin, make them refreshing. That happens all the time. But in the case of Tarkovsky, I feel like he created an entire language of cinema all its own. They don't even feel like films so much to me. They feel more like experiences. So it's like the idea of watching it makes you feel kind of disjointed. It's more of like you're kind of submerged by this abyss. They feel like cinematic poems, like essays, where you have all of these images, these extraordinary moments, and they all just sort of fit together, but very rarely in a literal way. I know that I have gotten so many requests to do Tarkovsky movies, and I've been really close a couple times. The reason that I haven't done it yet is because it is a little overwhelming, and I know there's a lot of expectation for it, so I really want to do it justice. I was all set to review one of his films, and after I watched it, I thought, you know what? I need to let this marinate a little bit more. I had seen it before, watched it again. I thought, you know, I still am not ready to review it. I'm going to watch it again a couple months later and then see where I arrive at. So yeah, it really has to do more with, I just want to respect the films themselves and I want to do them justice, but I think it'll happen sooner rather than later. I will say Stanley Kubrick, mostly because of his diverse themes and genres. Each one of his movies seem like they are directed by a different guy. At least that's the feeling I get. Although there is almost always a scene where something important happens in the bathroom / toilet. That's hilarious. You know what? Stanley Kubrick is somebody that I have studied and studied and studied over years, and that's one thing I never considered, is yes, a lot of weird things do happen in bathrooms. And when you look at movies as an extension of dreams, in dreams, whenever you have a dream in a bathroom, typically that's a symbol of, oh, there's something that's very intimate within you that maybe you're afraid of exposing, you may feel violated, it could be maybe something that's emotionally uncomfortable or whatever. That typically is symbolized by taking place in a bathroom, in dreams anyway. And when you watch a lot of Stanley Kubrick films, yeah, a lot of things where some information is being revealed, typically something big or, yes, intimate, does happen to be in a bathroom. And yeah, I mean, if you take away the literal story of it, that can sort of have an effect on it. Yeah, Stanley Kubrick is actually, I think, quite similar to Tarkovsky, though maybe not quite on Tarkovsky level for me, at least, in the sense that he is so individual. His influences are much more disguised than most filmmakers, most great filmmakers. But when I watch his movies, yeah, you know, he likes to study humanity as though he's like a distant observer, like he's an alien from a different planet. So everybody and everything feels very meticulous, very calculated, perfectly orchestrated. The shots are perfectly choreographed. And that distant feeling, that coldness, sometimes I think can be a detriment, but at other times I think it's really important to serving the entire story, particularly when you're watching something like 2001 A Space Odyssey. His work is really hard to describe. Again, it's very immersive. It's very much kind of ahead of its time. It feels extremely postmodern. But what's funny is you say here that it feels like each movie was directed by a different guy. I actually really disagree with that. I think that all of his films should be, like Kubrick films themselves should just be their own genre because they are so distinctly his. I actually think kind of the opposite. He was able to make films from all kinds of diverse genres and somehow they don't feel like pieces of that genre. They feel like Kubrick films. So, you know, he's tackling, you know, like satire, like black political comedy, as well as sci-fi, as well as, you know, like gladiator epics, as well as horror. But again, all so much his signature trademark. And no matter what character, no matter what era the film takes place in, because they are, again, so diverse, they all are within the same universe and they're all connected. They all feel that loneliness, that burden of existential crisis. So you can be Barry Lyndon in the Seven Years' War, you can be Jack Torrance in a hotel in 1980. The human condition is always the same and it repeats. David Fincher, he's quite meticulous about the little details that you notice, new things each time you watch his films. He also has a very cynical perspective that makes his storytelling so gripping and investing. He has had a massive impact on me as a filmmaker. I will always appreciate and be thankful for his contribution to the medium. Me too. I love David Fincher. I think that he is a true classicist at his roots when it comes to filmmaking. And I also think he's one of the most sophisticated when it comes to making kind of suspense thriller type movies. They're very much packaged to be enjoyable entertainment. And yet I think there's so much more underneath it. And he does it in a way. It reminds me of like Alfred Hitchcock. You know, he used to say that his movies are like a slice of cake, which is very true. Like they're very enjoyable, but yet there's a lot underneath it. And he's able to build on all of that through all of the suspense elements. And I think that Fincher, you know, a lot of people can describe him as a modern day Hitchcock. I know he's been described as that, but modern is the key word because David Fincher, as great as he is with, like Kubrick, he's one of the most detail-oriented directors, I think, in Hollywood. I mean, he will not stop till everything is absolutely perfect. And it shows in his aesthetic. It shows in the intricacies of every little shot. And I say little, no, every shot feels so like it's been orchestrated and thought of for months and months. It's always these little digital touches that he adds into his movies that create just a disconnect, a slight coldness that is very reflective of our world. It's like he's rooted in the classical world, in his influences, especially American filmmaking influences. And yet, there's something about it that is very much a modern sort of thing. And then when you watch movies like Social Network, that disjointed, cold feeling adds to the overall symbol of what it means. I truly think he's another director that got better and matured as he got older in terms of his storytelling abilities. You know, I know he made a lot of his very accessible movies, his very entertaining movies, like, you know, like Fight Club and Seven and whatnot, early in his career, but I feel like the films later, though they are more subtle, they're so much more sophisticated, so much more complex, ask more of you. Zodiac, to me, is his greatest film. I think that is an extraordinary film. I revisited it recently, and it is just as wonderful as I remember. And, you know, films like Gone Girl and The Social Network being one of the great collaborative efforts in terms of composer and filmmaker and writer. So yes, I think he's somebody who's made great decisions in his career, and that's why he's lasted. Gaspar Noé is my favorite director. The garish sex and violence, vibrant colors, pounding soundtracks, and restless Steadicam shots, he remains an instantly recognizable spectacle. I really have come to dislike how his reputation is some despised troublemaker producing superficial, disgusting movies, but I think his work is less childish provocation than a shock treatment, meant to reawaken the senses rather than desensitize. He has balls. His films reward me with an experience. I will always be there to see what he comes out with next. Well, you know my feelings on Gaspar Noé because I don't shut up about him. But yeah, Gaspar Noé is one of my favorite filmmakers working today, and everything you say is absolutely right. You're right. He's one of those directors that you are going to love or you are going to hate. I can't think of a director who fits that description more. I have talked to all kinds of people. Sometimes when they watch their movies, I've seen people get furious. Like, it really makes them angry. Like, I can't believe I just sat through that film. It's, for some people, it is like torture. And then for other people, it's a masterpiece, or, you know, and like for me, that's how I feel. He is one of those directors that does push more into the experience territory rather than, oh, I'm watching a movie, I am sitting in front of a screen. No, he plunges you into the experience more than almost any director. It feels very interactive. It feels like he's taking filmmaking to the next level because he's trying to create a psychedelic experience, which is reflecting kind of his philosophies and existentialism and all that, but very heavily drug-induced. So yes, you know, you've got these crazy neon colors and music that's really intense and often very interesting shots that go on forever, whether it's like a POV shot for Enter the Void, or, you know, it's like just that long Steadicam look that you see in like Irreversible or Climax. After a while, like the corners of the frame just kind of fizzle and dissolve and you are in there. And, you know, I think the reason people really dislike his films is because he's so unafraid to push you into the emotional places you're not comfortable with, which is similar to psychedelics. It pushes you to places where it's not always fun. It's actually a lot of suffering and struggling, but if you can push through that, it can be very rewarding. And that's how I look at Gaspar Noé films. Yes, it can push you into places where you feel disgusted and horrified, and at other times, it's so boring to some. It's like it pushes you to the point of boredom where it's almost like nauseating. So it's like, you know, he's pushing you so far into certain areas of the emotional spectrum that they kind of invert and they get twisted. So you don't really know how you feel about something. Yes, some people do think he's disgusting and exploitive. People really do. And I can understand where they're coming from, but I kind of disagree with that. I think that that's part of what makes him interesting. I think that's part of where the interesting questions come from. Are his films more voyeuristic, toxic experiences, or do they really give you a level of insight that maybe you didn't have before? I actually think it's a mix of both. I think that this is a for better or worse situation. His movies can entrance you, hypnotize you, and bring out some toxicity in you, as they certainly have for me, as well as give you perspective on it. So that is a very weird place to be and a very interesting place to be. So I think that if you can handle that, and if you really aren't afraid to kind of let go of all your inhibitions and not worry about what it means or anything like that, just feel it, That's a director you should really get into. Just I warn you ahead of time, he can be kind of tough and he can be kind of controversial to say the least. But yeah, those are just a handful of directors I have there. I will do another one of these, don't worry, but I just want to do, little ones here and there. But yeah, thank you guys so much for watching. If you look over here, you will see my Patreon supporters. The link to support is below. All my social media information is below that. You can watch more videos here, and you can subscribe if you'd like. Catch you next time.